Hi everyone, welcome back to my channel. So this video is going to be about Charles Hoskinson's reply to the video I made asking some questions about how Cardano will be implemented in the developing countries. So if you haven't seen that video, then this video might not make any real sense to you, but then that video is in that link and you can click on that link to have a look at the questions I had about Cardano's implementation in the developing world. So let's get straight into this. So I wasn't surprised at all that I got loads of backlash of loads of people. But what did surprise me was a lot of things I said were misconstrued and taken in a different light to what I was asking or even what I meant. Like, I'm not in any way trying to undermine Cardano. I mean, I don't think you guys understand that I'm Cardano's biggest fan and I really want him to succeed. So I take back saying that I think using the developing countries is a marketing tactic. Like some of you said, who am I? Yes, that's right. I'm a nobody and definitely too small to spread FUD. I mean, FUDers have like 100,000, 200,000 followers. So that should have made it quite obvious that spreading FUD wasn't my objective at all. All I was doing was asking questions that I thought deserved a response. And I'm happy that Charles was able to respond to my questions. And I'm hoping that after you guys hear Charles' response to my questions, your respect for Cardano will skyrocket, because my respect for Cardano after what Charles said to me has literally just gone up by 1,000,000%. No jokes. But then if backlashing me made you feel better or it makes you feel any better, then that's fine. But it doesn't affect me in any way. At least we have some answers now. So let's crack on. So Charles' response was via chat and Telegram. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to read the whole lot to you guys verbatim. It is far too early to commercialize tech in the developing world. I'm not even concerned with it. We have foundations and relationships to lay, but it is absurd and ridiculous to demand a comprehensive strategy and infrastructure when we are still turning on primary functionality. Yet, it's demanded. What bothers me about this whole affair is the utter lack of respect of time. This isn't a simple question. We're talking about a global scale problem. We're talking about something that is involving more than 100 countries and cultures, each with unique needs and considerations. And it is being assumed that apparently, unless we have a proper strategy, whatever the hell that means, that we have no idea what we are doing. Since you've taken time to make a video, I will respond directly to you here. Let me be extraordinarily clear that I take umbrage to this entire affair and you have been profoundly disrespectful. First, with all respect to cryptocurrencies, none are capable of serving the needs of even people in the developed world. None are capable of acting as a payment system or a proper means of exchange. None are capable of acting as a primary property ledger or identification system. None are capable of scaling to even modest daily use for a small country, nor are any of these systems mobile friendly. It's absurd and counterproductive to attempt any form of developing world proliferation when systems don't even work amongst the rich. That's the initial focus of our development effort, to correct these remedial problems prior to attempting adoption. We have been extraordinarily clear about our methodology. We have also partnered with many different organizations and groups that have a clear understanding of how to iterate to a reasonable solution. Second, let us discuss how we will get adoption within the developing world. IOHK was just here in Barbados. First, you cannot achieve mainstream adoption as a foreign entity. It's patronizing and completely misunderstands the dynamics of these countries. Along that thought, there are basic assumptions about capabilities and infrastructure that need to be true prior to any adoption. You need a value-stable token. You need low-cost cash-in, cash-out. You need participation from small business owners who are willing to host cash-in and cash-out points. You need ability to permit offline chain payments. You need a secondary network, such as a mesh network or satellite uplink, to act as a transaction relay system, where the primary internet is not stable. These are not simple problems, and they require different solutions based upon the actual countries we're talking about. So what are we doing? First,
we have to establish local representation within a collection of pilot countries that we'd actually like to innovate on. This is done via education as the entry point, and we have begun piloting this program in Barbados. In countries like Trinidad and Tobago, it's hard to get USD. Even ADA is value stable. Simply having a means of exchange will make it acceptable, or at least if volatility isn't hyperactive on a minute-by-minute basis. It simply means it coexists with fiat, which has many characteristics that you would expect to see in places like Africa, from a large unbanked population to a heavy reliance on remittances. I have people actually there right now, working with University of West Indies and local business leaders, training people from the company who will become permanent employees of our organization. Establishing a permanent presence requires a minimum 6 to 12 months doing this. Through a university and education for setting, this permits far better goodwill and government relationships. I personally met with the next Prime Minister and the Finance Minister, as well as the Education Minister. That's the next leader of the country. You get this kind of access when you embrace education and job creation. And we did this in a matter of months with local partners. The same can be done and is currently being done in Ethiopia. Once you have a stable base of operations and local personnel, the next step is to establish a collection of pilot programs to familiarize the government with the underlying technology. This includes things like property registration and unforgeable certifications like diplomas. The advantage is that all this type of contract can be done with a local labor using our technology. Concurrently, you can continue education programs, training hundreds of developers to be smart contract developers using our technology. This is extremely easy to do because we've noticed that every single place we have attempted, we have had an overwhelming level of applications. Barbados was several hundreds for just a dozen slots and only 2 months of notice. We expect even larger numbers in Ethiopia. Now, assuming we have a value-stable currency to work with, the next stage is ATM proliferation. You create an open-source ATM design that can run mostly off-grid and includes trusted hardware. The manufacturing cost needs to be below $500. Assuming you can acquire this setup, you can distribute about 1,000 for under $500,000, which is sufficient to cover an entire country. It's actually cheap enough to rent satellite spectrum for a few $100,000 a year to cover all of these devices in a country, which means you can now have a cash-in, cash-out point that can be owned by an independent business operator. This is now offline from the main internet, but capable of sending transactions anywhere in the world. You can use this point as a credential hub and a micro-lending system. From there, you can explore micro-lending schemes such as those done by Mohamed Yunus by the Grameen Bank. You can also have discussions about distribution of foreign aid through these points via pilot programs. We have had hundreds of conversations throughout the years with people ranging from the World Bank to the United Nations. There is a desire, but just simply a lack of infrastructure to run these low-cost pilots. But my point here is that the cost to provide infrastructure for an entire country with these schemes is in the millions. The cost to train the thousands of people necessary to run these things is in the hundreds of thousands. We have already begun executing on that model, yet this somehow escapes you. I am literally flying out to Barbados to check up on this very process. It consumes a considerable amount of my time, but you seem to be more obsessed with the time I spend on Twitter. As a final point, things that take years and are done in extremely difficult stages will not be explained via one paragraph or interview. I have spent years of my life on this task. I traveled to now nearly 40 countries in the last 3 years. And if I have to go to 100 before it's all done, I will. But the entire point of this technology is that the work is done by the people on ground who actually live there. I cannot, by definition, solve the financial problems of people in Africa, the Caribbean, or South America. They have to solve their own problems. I can give them access to the best infrastructure, knowledge, and technology the world has available, and I can fly out my best people to work with them. But ultimately, adoption and integration has to be done by local hands. Yet, if M-Pesa, the internet, and cell phone adoption are any indication, there is ample evidence that this endeavor will be successful. So I'm going to spend the next half decade of my life giving it a shot.
So yeah, and then he listed a few countries that he was going to and said that some of these strategies are not politically correct and therefore cannot be publicly stated. So I'll post the link to his response on my Steam it because I don't have a website or anywhere else to post it. So if you guys want to have another read of what he said and the plans for implementation are, you can have a look on my Steam it. So thanks for watching, guys, and I will see you on my next video. Bye.